Hi, I'm Norman Wahlberger. In today's video, we want to connect the notion of spread with the idea of a determinant. So we want to apply determinants to rational trigonometry to explain the replacement of an angle, an algebraic replacement of an angle, which is called the spread, which is, of course, absolutely crucial for rational trigonometry. Let me remind you what that is. So here we have two lines, this one here and this one here, and the spread between those two lines, denoted S. In terms of this right triangle here, with quadrants as P, Q, and R, the spread S is defined as Q over R, the ratio of the opposite quadrants to the hypotenuse quadrants. So that ratio is the spread. Now, we also have seen that there's an alternate formula for it in terms of the equations of the lines. So if we're in the ordinary xy axes, and here's a line L1, and here's a line L2, and suppose that L1 has the equation a1x plus b1y plus c1 equals 0, and L2 has the corresponding equation a2x plus b2y plus c2 equals 0. In that case, the spread between the two lines is this particular relation. A1B2 minus A2B1 squared all over the product of A1 squared plus B1 squared times A2 squared plus B2 squared. And again, we see that it's algebraic. So if these things are rational numbers, then the spread is a rational number. We do not have to go outside our number system that we're using to describe points and lines in order to measure the separation between points and lines. That's a very novel idea if you're not familiar with rational trigonometry, but it's really at the heart of why this is such a powerful and, in fact, general notion, because it applies no matter what kind of number system you have, even if you have a finite field or some different kind of field, you can still establish these kinds of formulas. Now, today we want to concentrate on a third understanding of the spread, which is a vector interpretation. So we now suppose that we have two vectors in the plane, V, which is, say, AB, and W, which is CD. If we translate these vectors, we can have them both emanate from the origin. And those two vectors are then going to determine a spread. There's going to be a spread between those two vectors. And we want a formula for what that spread is in terms of the coordinates of the vectors. And here is the result, that the spread between V and W is AD minus BC squared over A squared plus B squared times C squared plus D squared. Okay, so that's a formula for the spread between two vectors. And it has a very similar formula to the formula that we saw for the spread between two lines. In fact, it's almost the same, and we're going to see why that is. So why is that formula correct? Here's the explanation. There's the vector V, which is AB. There's the vector W, which is CD. We've moved the vectors so that they're emanating from the origin. Now let's consider the lines that are passing through those vectors and the origin. In other words, the lines that are emanating from the origin in the direction of those two vectors. So these lines are going to have the following equations. So the line that's in this direction, the AB direction, will have equation minus BX plus AY equals 0. Let's check why that is. First of all, this is a line that passes through the origin because it has no constant term. So if you plug 0, 0 in here, then it's satisfied. And we can also see that if you plug in AB for X and Y, then you get minus BA plus AB, which is indeed 0. So this point here, the point AB, also lies on the line. And so this is the line that's in this direction. Similarly, the line through the origin in the W direction has equation minus dx plus cy equals 0. Okay, so now we know what the spread between these two lines is because we can apply the equation that we know for this spread between two lines. What do we do? Well, we take this thing here times this thing here, and we subtract the product of this times this, and we square all of that. And then we divide by this coefficient squared plus this coefficient squared times this coefficient squared plus this coefficient squared. And we've just unraveled this here. Inside we have a plus AD minus BC. So all of that is AD minus BC squared in the numerator. And then the denominator becomes A squared plus B squared, C squared plus D squared. So this is indeed the correct formula for the spread created by two vectors. Okay, it's a beautiful formula that's very important formula that's in fact showing us just why the spread is such an obviously important thing. You can see that it's important because it's a determinant which is normalized by these two quadrances, really. Rational trigonometry provides us with a precise way of making measurements in two-dimensional space, and then ultimately in higher dimensional space as well. So it's a big difference between calculating things exactly and precisely, which this system does, and the classical system that's currently taught, which is basically an approximate system, and that relies on approximations involving calculators. Okay, so I want to impress upon you the superiority of thinking in terms of rational trigonometry by looking at an example. Okay, so here is an example in the plane, a triangle OAB. O is the origin, A is the point 4, 2, B is the point minus 1, 3. And we're interested in studying that triangle. In particular, we're interested in the spreads S, R, and T at three vertices. Okay, so to apply the vector form of the spread, which is what we want to get some practice at, let's first determine the vectors. So the vector OA is 4, 2, the vector OB is minus 1, 3, and the vector AB is the difference of coordinates, so we take minus 1, minus 4, it's minus 5, and 3 minus 2 is 1. Okay, we have three vectors. So what about this spread S? How do we calculate that? Well, we look at the two vectors, here and here, these are these two vectors, and we apply the formula that we've just learned. The determinant here is 4 times 3 minus 2 times minus 1, so 12 minus minus 2, and we have to square that. Divided by 4 squared plus 2 squared times minus 1 squared plus 3 squared. And you can check that that's 49 over 50. That's pretty close to being 1. We've seen 49.50 before. That's close to being 1, and that's almost a right angle, or almost perpendicular sides there, but not quite. How about this spread here, T? Well, in this case, the vectors are this one here and this one here. Okay, so we're going to use the OB vector and the AB vector. Now, it turns out that it doesn't matter whether you use AB or minus AB, because if you scale any one of these vectors by any multiple, as long as it's non-zero, then the spread is not going to change. Okay, so we're going to take these two vectors and we're going to compute. So we have this product here minus this product here. In fact, actually, if you were emanating from here, you would have to take the negatives of both of these vectors, but it doesn't matter. So this times this minus this times this, I guess we have a 1 minus 15 here, although perhaps minus 1 plus 15 would be better. Let me actually change that. Minus 1 plus 15 is going to be the same answer. All of that squared. And divided by the sum of the squares here and the product of the sum of the squares there. So we get a 14 squared divided by a 10 times a 26, and that turns out to be 49 over 65. So that is the spread T there. And finally, the spread R, which is over here. Well, that involves the vectors OA and AB, so the first vector and the third vector. In fact, if we're at this point here, then we would use the negative of this one, and we would use this one here. All right, then we would get minus 4 times 1, minus 2 times, actually minus 2 times minus 5, So we would get minus 4 minus 10 all squared. Divided by the sum of the squares here and the sum of the squares here, multiplied together, and that gives us 49 over 130. So a relatively simple, just application of that vector formula for the spread allows us to obtain pretty simply exact precise values for the three spreads of this triangle. And I want you to appreciate how different this is from classical trigonometry, which has no way of really getting at the angles precisely, only in an approximate fashion. Okay. So classical trigonometry necessarily only involves typically approximate quantities. Here, typically, things are exact quantities. So it's a huge difference. We are not leaving pure mathematics here. We're staying in the context of pure mathematics, exact arithmetic, precise answers. Very powerful difference. And it's a great exercise for you to calculate the corresponding angles of this triangle and compare what those things look like with these. It's a world of difference. So let's have a good look at the spreads and quadrants of this triangle. So here are the spreads we've just found, 49 over 50, 49 over 65, 49 over 130. And the quadrants are easy because they're just sums of squares. The quadrants here is just 4 squared plus 2 squared, which is 20. Here it's 3 squared plus 1 squared, which is 10. And here it's 5 squared plus 1 squared, which is 26. So here we have a rather arbitrary kind of triangle in the plane. We see that we can relatively easily calculate the spreads and the quadrants completely exactly. This is an amazing thing in rational trigonometry, completely alien to the classical story where there are very few triangles that students can actually get complete control over, which, as I've mentioned many a time and probably will mention many a time more, which is why the mathematical establishment around the world always resorts to the 1-1 root 2 triangle and the 1-2 root 3 triangle for examples, test questions, problems. Okay, around the world, even in universities, we're always using those, basically those two very special triangles to cook up examples to give our students so that they will be able to use their understanding of 30 degrees, 45 degrees, and 60 degrees, essentially, in order to solve essentially baby problems. Okay, it's very, very, very limiting. We can see, I hope, that this is a very general kind of scenario. You can calculate in a much broader way. And the fundamental relations of trigonometry captured here in these three formulas for this triangle. Let's just review them. The spread law, which is telling you that a spread divided by the opposite quadrants is the same as another spread divided by its opposite quadrants is the same as another spread divided by its opposite quadrants. The cross law, which is a relationship between the three quadrants and one of the spreads. So there are in fact three cross laws. So what does it say? This quadrant plus this quadrant minus this quadrant all squared is 4 times the product of these two quadrants times 1 minus the spread that those two quadrants form, or that the two lines form. And finally, the perhaps most spectacular one, the relationship between the three spreads. Okay, that's the equation that the sum squared is twice the sum of the squares, plus 4 times the product. So there's actually a cubic term here. These are analogs of the sine law, the cosine law, and the fact that the three angles of a triangle sum to, what's that number? Pi. 3.1415926, etc., etc. going on indefinitely, farther and further and further out. Okay, people think that that's a simple formula. It's not a simple formula. This is vastly simpler than that formula. Vastly simpler, even though it may not appear so, because we never actually deal with the full pi. We just deal with some small little approximation to it. In which case, things are simpler, yes, but they're also wrong. Okay, three absolutely fundamental formulas in mathematics, core formulas for rational trigonometry, really proving, I think, to any objective observer that this is really a more powerful theory, a more powerful trigonometry than the one that's currently taught in pretty well all the schools and universities around the world. So, mathematics educators, we need to catch up. We need to enter the beautiful world of rational trigonometry. So here's that formula again, the formula for the spread made by two vectors, vector AB, vector CD, and there's the spread, AD minus BC squared over A squared plus B squared, C squared plus D squared. And you may say, well, this is a little bit hard to remember, but in fact, it's not too hard to remember at all if you keep in mind the geometrical content of it. Okay, the geometrical content is crucially that this AD minus BC is a determinant and represents the area or the signed area of the parallelogram formed by V and W. Okay, so it's a signed area which depends on the orientation, that if you change the order of the two vectors, then the sign of the area changes. But note that this quantity, this determinant, is squared. And that means that that reversal in sign when you interchange things no longer matters because we're squaring things. So when we square a signed or oriented quantity, we typically get an unoriented quantity independent of the sign. That's exactly what happens here. So this is just the square of the area of the parallelogram. And on the bottom is really a normalization. Okay, so we're saying that the spread is actually the square of the area of this parallelogram. But obviously then if we multiply the vectors by scalars, then we could make this parallelogram be arbitrarily big or small. So to get a number that doesn't depend on the actual sizes of the vectors, but only on their directions, we want to normalize the area squared. And conveniently, we just use the product of the quadrants of V times the quadrants of W. So that's another way of thinking about what a spread is, very geometrically. It's the area of a parallelogram squared, which is normalized by dividing by the product of the two quadrants of the vectors that form that parallelogram. That's a very beautiful and important interpretation, and shows yet again why the spread is absolutely really a fundamental quantity. And now with this preparation, we're prepared to see how the same formulas manifest themselves in some different geometries, in the red geometry and the green geometry of a relativistic nature, which together with this Euclidean blue geometry form this wonderful trio called chromogeometry. So in our next video, we're going to see that the same kinds of formulas apply, but maybe with a little bit of a twist, because we do have to make some concession to the fact that we're moving from the Euclidean story to a relativistic story, which is very, very interesting and important for 20th century physics. So I hope you'll join me for that. I'm Norman Wahlberger. Thanks for listening.